you're locked into the story. When that you that is locked into the story is no more, there's only freedom, but there isn't any one that's free. Me. There's boundlessness, and in boundlessness, which is actually simply absolute love, it's the absolute unconditional love. Of course, unconditional love embraces everything, tyranny, ugliness, discomfort. After liberation, discomfort still happens. You know, it isn't suddenly that you're walking in the Elysian fields in absolute heaven. Yeah. There's nobody walking, there's just what happens. And that can include pain, unhappiness, but pain, discomfort, all those things happen. So there aren't any rules. You can't say that liberation is about what we think of as goodness.
Would you experience fear, anxiety sometimes?
I wouldn't experience fear, but fear happens.
Okay.
So there's nobody anymore experiencing anything. There's just what happens, and that can include fear.
That fear is happening in your personality, presumably?
It's just happening. It's a feeling. I mean, in the end, fear is a very simple thing. It's just a feeling in the body. Yeah. Isn't it? It's a sense of something hot, and if you like, which happens. But, of course, now that it's not happening to anyone, there's nobody taking delivery of it. There's nobody taking fear home to tea. Thinking. Thinking still happens after liberation, but there's no one listening.
Okay, so the fear can't really anchor itself.
No, there's nothing to anchor it. It falls back out into nothing. Everything comes out of nothing and falls back into it.
Okay.
It's like there's no, you know, after liberation there's no me, therefore there's no stickiness. It's one way I put it, you know.
Yeah.
There's just life, and there's nothing getting in the way, identifying. And the aliveness that I speak about is the aliveness of emptiness and fullness, of nothing and everything. This is the nature of radical aliveness. It comes out of source, it comes out of nothing, and it is nothing appearing as everything. So there's a different fullness in it. It's a wholeness that we can't see all the time that we are something, an individual. All the time that we are an individual, we don't see clearly. We see through a veil, and when we look with the eyes of a businessman, because somewhere when we look at things as separate individuals, we either look to protect ourselves from what is seen or to get something from that which is seen. We don't look as lovers, we look as business people. That's natural. There's nothing right or wrong with that. That's the way it is. That's the game that oneness plays, pretending to be two, pretending to be fine, pretending to be greedy. That's the game. There's nothing right or wrong with it. That's the way it is.
And people say, well, Huey, you're very violent. Why are you so violent? Huey, you sit up and talk about spears and penetration and stab people with toothpicks. And I say, well, hold on, wait a minute, time out on the court. Existence is violent. I exist, therefore I'm violent in that way.
Then afterwards, when there is no one, what is seen uncluttered, just what it is, the expression of unconditional love.
Land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice. What else do we want, people? Huh? Peace. I got your peace. Rest in peace.
If everyone realized that they are not separate individuals, would bad things still be happening?
Yes, but there is no one that realizes that.
You don't read about the survival programs that we had going on for the people, free children breakfast program, trying to feed some of these little hungry kids before they go off to school in the morning. You don't read about that. You don't read about the educational program that we had going on for these kids, for the older folks as well. You don't read about the shoe giveaway, clothing giveaway, coat giveaway that we had going on back east so people don't freeze to death during the winter months. You don't read about that. You don't read about the free prison busing program where we bus people from the communities out to the prison, to the penitentiaries, so that people can visit the loved ones who are incarcerated. You don't read about that. You don't read about the free ambulance service every head going on in Winston-Salem.
So-called liberation, for want of a better word, is the end of someone realizing something, there being someone who would realize or experience anything. It's the end of me. It's death, it's the end. There's nothing left. And yes, things would go on apparently happening.
But also bad things, like wars
There aren't any bad things. There aren't any good things. There's only what apparently happens.
The greatest threat to the internal security in United States of America was the free children's breakfast program.
Good morning!
I can't hear you. Good morning!
Good morning!
In the me story, that there is something called good and bad. Because the me story is subject-object, the me story is dualistic. Therefore, it splits everything into two, including something being bad and something being good. When that collapses, what collapses with it is the idea that there's something that's good or bad. And it's very obvious, absolutely obvious, that all there is what's happened.
She got my back. This is my back guy. Appreciate it.
What is the advantage of that then?
Sorry, there's what no advantage. This is there is absolutely nothing here for the individual at all. Nothing. It's the end of the individual. What's been suggested here is that suddenly the individual who wants an advantage can collapse. And then there's nothing that has an advantage or doesn't.
First of all, I'd like to say all power to the people. There's your Minister of Defense, Huey P. Newton, speaking live and direct from the belly of the beast, the den of wolves, where Big Brother's always watching you, CMC East, the state penitentiary. They say that this is a preferred prison. Some of the inmates in here seem to think that it is a preferred prison, but you know and I know that this is just a little prison. The big prison is on the outside. This is just the outside in miniature. But like the poem by Dryden, I should like to say that even if paradise were my prison, I should still like to leap the crystal wall.
Everything just seems so unstable.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the banks nearly collapsed a few weeks ago, and there was terrible problems somewhere in Africa on the news this morning with people rioting and no food. You feel sorry for them. Mm. Does that, when you watch the news on TV, like you see people suffering, does that somehow affect Tony?
Well, there is no Tony, but what is seen is what's happening. Of course, the other thing that's amazing about this, I mean, I meet people who think they're individuals and they are suffering much more degree than Uganda or wherever it is at the Congo. But in a sense, what's happening is that they feel they're suffering and they think that suffering is happening to them. But when, from this point of view, it is seen that there's no one there that's happening to, that's absolute love. And in some way or other, that which thinks it's suffering senses that. There's nobody suffers, there's just suffering.
Yeah, and I guess...
But, I mean, it's easy to say that. Those are just words.
Yeah, and those people, they don't have... They don't have an overview. They don't have food. Their kids are starving.
It would be totally inappropriate for me to go to the Congo and say, there's no one there. Yeah. But in answer to your question, that's the leap.
Yeah. Is there hope for humanity?
There doesn't have to be, because everything that's happening is simply the expression of wholeness.
Yeah.
Wholeness isn't interested in, you know, somehow saving this earth or anybody becoming enlightened, because seeking and suffering is wholeness.
I think we need to be clear about something here. After liberation, there is nothing that is aware of oneness, and there's nothing that knows oneness or wholeness. Wholeness can't be known by something, or there can't be something that is aware of wholeness. All that's left is wholeness. See, that's a confusing statement. It's here right now. It almost is like the message, "Well, be here now," which is, of course, a superficial nonsense. There is no one that can be here now, and there is no here and now to be in. The idea that you are already that is also confusing as far as I'm concerned, because it implies in some way or other that this is something to do with you. There is no you. There is no me. There is no individuality. All there is what is. And, you know, there's quite a lot of dualistic messages which talk about you finding this and you realizing that this is only a thought or a belief, or you becoming aware of wholeness. And that's confusing, because you never will. The whole idea that the individual is going to find this is the dilemma.
Political activism is just what happens, though by no one.
I know, but thinking is only a symptom of separation. It's not separation. The idea that our thinking is somehow separation is like saying that a sneeze is a cold. The fact is that our whole body feels separate. Separation is an energy, it's not a thought. Yes, okay, thinking feeds the story of separation, but all that only has any significance to the me, the individual that's listening to the thinking. When that me collapses, the thinking goes on happening, but no one's listening. And so it loses its power. It only has a power all the time there's someone listening to the thought and thinking it's important.